I've preached it once before in my life, only once. And you have to preach a sermon 20 times. First of all, you have to master the sermon, and the sermon has to master you. There's no other way to preach. One of the most fascinating parts of the scripture is that blank between Malachi and Matthew. It covers a period of 400 years without any prophetic voice. 400 years of darkness without any prophetic light. And then suddenly, unexpectedly and unwantedly, there's a break. At the other side of that 400 years, when Malachi finishes message, do you remember what he says? He says, "The Lord whom ye seek." Do you know why one reason we don't have revival? We're not seeking revival, we're seeking miracles, we're seeking manifestations, we're not seeking Christ. And he's a very jealous God. But you see, the Lord comes suddenly. I was in a meeting last week, I preached to 1,500 preachers one night and 1,500 the next night. And suddenly in the midst of preaching, I said, if your heart begins to burn with conviction, if you're burning with lust, if you're burning with a problem, and you believe the fire of the Holy Ghost can change it, get up and walk. And while I was preaching, men streamed to the altar. They filled the whole altar up. And then as we finished, I said, you ladies can pray where you are. You men come, pastors come, teachers come, preachers come, Sunday school teachers come. You've no fire, you've no anointing. And they streamed forward, about 150 filled the altar. The next day it was greater. There were 300 men sought God. It was wall-to-wall men. I couldn't get off the platform. I was tired out. But you see, the Lord suddenly came. If we announced the Lord was coming tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock in this church, you'd pack the place out. But he comes suddenly. What does it say? While shepherds watch their flocks by night, surely. And suddenly there's a sound of the heavenly host. They were waiting, countdown. Do you think they were stupid? Those men in the upper room knew the 50th day. And they were counting down, this is the 48th, 49th, tomorrow the Holy Ghost will come. And it says, suddenly there was a sound of a heavenly host. Paul and Silas were in prison, and suddenly, I'm looking for God, the Holy Ghost, to come suddenly. Not any locality, not in any nation, but to fulfill his promise, he will pour out his spirit on all flesh. The world has never nearer been to judgment than it is now. There are 5 billion people in the human race. That's too many to fill hell. We're not going to cure the ills of America by politics. Only God can save us. We need a divine intervention. We need God to rend the heavens and come and disturb us. And to do that, he'll show us our bankruptcy. He'll show us that we have to be stripped before he'll clothe us, empty before he'll fill us, plead our poverty before he'll make us rich. This is a crisis hour, not only in America, it's a crisis hour in the world. One young friend of mine this week has been speaking in the greatest hall in the world, in China, in the People's Hall, which holds maybe 7,000 people. He's speaking there at a banquet. He's a Christian. He said, I didn't go as an American, they'll kick me out. I'm going as a believer. I'm going to tell them what the answer is. After all, there's 1 billion people in that nation. Many are suffering persecution and hardship and great suffering. And he has gone there with a burden because he wants to see God come. I'll tell you why I went to that church. A few weeks ago, I cancelled all my preaching for this year except here and one other place. I should have gone to a world conference. I said, I'm not coming. I should have gone to 2 state conferences. I said, I'm not coming. And once you say that, of course, everybody wants you. But I've held off so far. I went up to this conference not just to preach to 1,500 preachers every night, but the church is unique in America. Listen, this is America today, not Finney's day, not Wesley's day. There's something happening in that church that does not happen in any other church in America, not even John Wimber's big church, or my friend Charles Stanley at the First Baptist there in Atlanta, or the First Baptist Dr. Criswell in Dallas. I'll tell you why. That church has 6 small churches. They all operate independently during the week. They meet together on Sunday morning. They meet together Friday night, about 1,400 or 1,500 people. They have 5 pastors. One of them has a Fulbright scholarship. In England, everybody wants the Rhodes scholarship. In America, the Fulbright is the highest. You get that? It's open door to millions of dollars. Open Sesame. Well, he's left it on one side. He's not going to Oxford for that scholarship. He's come to work for $18,000 a week. That's what I get. Oh, I got wrong there. I mean, I earn it, but I never get it. $18,000 a year, isn't that something? Another young man, he took a 500% cut in his wage to take a job at $18,000 a year. He had a private car with a telephone. He has a daddy who's a multimillionaire. He has an unlimited credit card, and he put it all on one side. Frank, that's encouraging, isn't it? God, there are some young men aren't gold diggers. You'll tell the evangelist when you get to heaven, the streets are gold. They'll be digging the streets up. That water's terrible. But then there's another man in Africa heard that there's a church. For the 5 years, they've had 2 hours prayer every morning, 2 hours prayer every afternoon, 2 hours prayer every night, plus a night of prayer every week. Well, dear God, we went down, dear Martha and our son David and I, and the Lord just moved on the place again. So the Saturday night prayer meeting that goes from 7 to 9 went for 8 hours non-stop in intercession and tears. The morning prayer meetings that start at 6 and finish at 8 went through till 10:30 in the morning. The nights of prayer, they get 50, 60, 70 people praying the whole night through. They're not praying for the material recovery of the economy, they're praying for the glory of God. You see, our generation, there are not 100 people in America tonight have ever seen a Holy Ghost revival. I mean, a meeting where you didn't put the lights out. The sanctuary is alive 24 hours a day. One of the greatest prayer meetings in history started on the 21st of August in, 1727 in Moravia. The Holy Spirit came down just as the clock went to 11 o'clock. The Spirit descended. You know what happened to that group of people from 11 o'clock that morning? For 100 years, the prayer meeting never ended. You could go in prayer meeting at 2 o'clock in the morning, and children would be praying with tears. Their finest young men went and stood on the slave blocks down there in the Caribbean, St. Thomas and St. Croix and so forth, and sold themselves into slavery in order that they might get the gospel out. Okay, let me go back a minute here. Jesus said of John the Baptist, what? There's no man ever born of woman that was greater than John the Baptist. Let me tell you how it began. It says in Luke chapter 1 and verse 10, the whole multitude of people were praying in at the time of incense. Isn't that wonderful? They were praying a great prayer meeting in that old temple. What happened? There appeared unto an angel of the Lord, verse 11, standing on the right side of the altar. I won't go into the details there, but he says in verse 13, fear not, Zacharias, thy prayer is heard. Thy wife Elizabeth shall bear thee a son, and thou shalt call his name John. He shall have joy and gladness, and many shall rejoice at his birth. He shall be great in the sight of God. It says in verse 32, he shall be great, and he shall be called the Son of the Highest. Oh, that's of Jesus too. But here is a man. What does Zacharias say? Let me quote it, paraphrase it. He says, look, don't talk like that. My wife's old and stricken. She can't bear children. You've got people in America tell me I'm crazy. I prayed for revival more than 60 years, and I'm more sure than ever now that it's coming. I'm getting old and frail. You fight the devil, he'll hit you back. I was thinking today when dear Joyce and her precious husband came to see me in hospital, I was dying. In the last 5 years, I've had 3 strokes, different strokes, of course, and 2 heart attacks. The devil fought back, and he's likely to do that. But you see, revival comes after barrenness. Can you imagine, what's his name now, Abraham's wife, Sarah? You mentioned her this morning. What was she, 90? Can you imagine her writing up to her mother and saying, "Mother, I'm expecting a baby." She said, "What? You're crazy. You should never have married a preacher." They're crazy. It's amazing how often God in the Word of God shows us how the impossible is possible, and yet we doubt him. We're the biggest generation of doubting believers the world's ever had. And they call her some other name there. Joyce said this morning, we're almost arrogant to say we're Christians. You see, what happens in meetings usually, I pick up Christian magazines, I don't buy them. They're not worth anything. But again and again it says, know your Bible. Take this Bible course. Take this Bible course. Take this Bible course on prophecy. Take this Bible course on the blood. Listen. The great need is not to know the Word of God. The great need is to know the God of the Word. What does Daniel say? Does Daniel say the people that do know their Bible shall be strong into exploits? Of course not. The people that do know their God. Why did Jesus come into the world? You say to save sinners. That's what he said. Jesus said, I've come that they may know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. Anyhow, this young man is this man is like others. Sarah brought forth a beautiful son. But you know, have you ever discovered this? When you try to help God out, you get into trouble. The Lord says, you're going to have a son. And you quoted, did the Lord say to him? Or were you wrong this morning? Son? The Lord told him to take the woman? No, the woman. Who was the other woman? Did the Lord tell him to take Hagar? Come on now, cough it up. If you're wrong, confess your sin right here. Oh, what? That's not the King James Version. Yeah, but you know what happened? After he listened to Sarah, God never spoke to him again for 15 years. One for me. That NASB, NASB, that's Greek for nasty. Because in Hebrews 1, I love that verse in Hebrews 1, God who at sundry times and in divers manners spake unto the fathers by the prophets hath in these last days spoken unto us. These last days, 2,000 years ago, the book of the Revelation, these last days, 2,000 years ago, in God's name, where are we now? People say it's 10 minutes to 12 on God's clock. It isn't. It's 30 seconds to 12. We're on the edge of the greatest events in history. But there it says in the NASB, well, let me finish that verse. When he had by himself purged our sins. You see, there's a propagation. One of the popular preachers, I'll tell you, it's James Robinson, says every day almost on TV in Dallas there, remember, we're all to be one. Bunkum. Jesus didn't put his hand on the shoulder of a Pharisee and his hand on the shoulder of a Sadducee and let's all be one. He didn't say that. He uses John 17:6. But notice what Jesus says there, Father, them which thou hast given to me, they have kept thy word. What did Jesus say to the Pharisees, you whited sepulchres, you children of the devil? Do you make league with the children of the devil? Of course not. I don't believe I have to accept the Virgin Mary as co-redemptrix. What does it say in Philippians? Paul says, I weep when I think of those... How to use the phrase there? In Philippians 3, they had walked with God anyhow, he said. They are enemies of the cross of Christ. You say, but everywhere the Catholics have crucifixes. Sure, but it doesn't say they're enemies of Christ, it says they're enemies of the cross. And they say that Mary is co-redemptrix, that she too bore the sins of people. That's a lie from hell, she didn't. You know, the biggest trouble ahead of us is not we're going to run into collision with a communist, we're going to run into collision with the Roman Catholic Church, and hell will break loose. And as dear sister said today, you better be anchored. If you're not anchored, you'll be shifted around with every wind of doctrine. When here comes this wonderful man, look what it says about John the Baptist, verse 15 of Luke 1. He should be great in the sight of wine, he should drink neither wine nor strong drink. Listen, do you hear what it says? It doesn't say this of any other man that ever lived, not even of Jesus. It says John the Baptist was filled with the Holy Ghost from where? From his mother's womb. I'm looking at another verse here. Verse 23. Or maybe it's the next chapter. Anyhow, it says somewhere in that chapter, his pastor, Simeon, was filled with the Holy Ghost. It says in verse 67, and his father Zacharias was filled with the Holy Ghost and prophesied. Now what else? Verse 41. It came to pass Elizabeth heard the salutation of Mary. The babe leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Ghost. Isn't that something? His father filled with the Holy Ghost, his mother filled with the Holy Ghost. And when she, like this precious lady, I prayed for your baby this morning when you were snoring. I prayed for your baby this morning. And when the child was in the body of Elizabeth, immediately Elizabeth came into contact with Mary, who had Christ in her. Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Ghost, and the baby in her was filled with the Holy Ghost. You better watch your children. Take care. I'd love to hear E.V. Hill. I've never heard him. I think he's the greatest preacher in America. Dear black man, I'd love to hear him. I heard him say something the other week I thought was wonderful. He said, take care of your children. Watch who they marry, he said, with his witticism of Solomon. He said, remember, you don't get racehorses out of mules. Isn't that good? Be careful who they marry. You all look very sad when I said that. So he's filled with the Holy Ghost. Oh, verse 25 says, well, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. The first time I came here, Joyce, Rick was preaching, and Martha and I were sitting on one side, and Rick Joyner came over, and he'd never seen me in his life. He said, you're Simeon. I said, I'm what? He said, you're Simeon. You've prayed for more than half a century for prayer. You're going to live until a baby's born. I saw a man up in, where were we, sweetie? Oh, yes, three. My secretary is great. The only thing she can't drive. People ask me, do your wife drive? I say, no, that's why we're here. Boy, one of the happiest days in her life was when they restored the speed limit. She said, we can go 65 now. But four different people have said to me in the last year, you're Simeon. None of them knew that the other had said it. You're going to live to see the coming of the baby being revival. There are people praying all over America. Young men are calling me all over the nation, getting up at 6 in the morning, praying 2 and 3 hours. For a Holy Ghost revival. Oh, people say, Brother Randall, you know, our churches are filled every Sunday morning. Sure, for an hour. Our jails are filled 24 hours a day. Our divorce courts are filled. Boy, if they reverse that Wade-Roe order, America will be a butcher's shop next year, and the judgment of God will be accelerated. You can't live in a country with 600 million Bibles and do break every commandment you preached about this morning. You can't do it. God says, my spirit shall not always strive with man. You see, Jesus says, did you go out in the wilderness to see a reed shaken by the wind? No, you went to see a sturdy man. He said he's not a prophet. He's more than a prophet. Why? The prophets are the most exclusive men who ever lived. Let me tell you what an old Jewish Christian said in America years ago. He's a brilliant Hebrew scholar. And he says that the prophet, by the very nature of his calling, is a tragic figure. He suffers for the people, he suffers with the people, he suffers by the people. And he's a tragic figure because he has a fierce loyalty to God and he has a great compassion for a rebellious, blind, stupid people that are heading for judgment. When God is angry with a nation, she has no prophets. We don't have a prophet in America. The biggest enemy to revive in America is evangelism, spurious, cheap evangelism that brings people to the front. And it lets them go unsaved. They're not born again of the Spirit of God. They make a decision and there's nothing. My darling wife and I were in a meeting. A lady came to the front. She came in the meeting late. And she kind of wobbled down the aisle. She was a bit overweight. And she had a great big mop of hair. Borrowed. But I thought, well, lady, if God gets hold of you, you'll be in the mess tonight. Surely enough, at the end, I preached on he must be born again. She came to the altar. I said to the men, all you men go in that room. You women come in this room. So I went with the men. An hour after the altar call was given, the pastor came and he said, help me with this woman. I said, you stay and I will. I won't stay with women alone in the room. So she burst into tears. And she said, Mr. Rainey, I want to tell you something. This is the 14th time I've come to an altar to be saved. And suddenly puts her arm around me and says, don't weep, dearie. Jesus paid it all. You have nothing to do. Just believe he died and rose again. She said, nothing happened. Paul flings in the face of the world, the flesh and the devil, if any man be in Christ. Does he know what he's talking about? Sure he does. He wrote Romans 7. He had the greatest picture of depravity the world's ever known. And he says you can be twisted and perverted and damned, but Jesus Christ, you may be incurable to everybody else, but he's able to save to the uttermost all who come unto God by him. And if any man be in Christ, he doesn't just get his lousy sins forgiven. He's a new creation. He has a new heart. He has a new mind. He has new language. He has new interests. All things have passed away. You see, we accommodate sin today. I preached with a very brilliant preacher, a national broadcaster some years ago, in a certain university, and as he finished, the young people all dashed up and said, sign my Bible, sign my autograph. Others had cameras. I pulled his coat tail. I said, sir, I don't want your autograph or your photograph. I said, I don't idolize men. I said, I followed you very interested tonight. I said, look at the crowd. There were 1,000 college kids going out. I said to him, your message was interesting, but you left a big loophole. I said, all the time you talked about sin, I was talking about a woman that came to Jesus, a very bad woman. And Jesus said to her, go and sin less. He said, what? I said, that's what you made out. You can sin and repent and sin, you don't. We'll never in this life be in a place where we're not able to sin, but by grace we can be in a place where we're able not to sin. As dear Joyce said this morning, you've got the possibility of being the rottenest harlot that America's ever seen, or the rottenest criminal. But God has come and intervened in your life, and he's taken away your appetite for sin. You don't want it anymore. You loathe the things you used to love. You hate them. You turn your back on them. If any man is in Christ, he does not commit sin habitually. If he commits sin, it's by accident, but he gets up and he runs to the cross and asks for cleansing. And gets quickened again by the Spirit of God. But dear Lord, I don't think John was very fair. Can I take my coat off, you mind? My son wouldn't ask you, he'd just throw his coat off. I'm coming apart.
Let me see my pocket.
Dear, dear. You got me into this, Joyce. But listen, have you ever thought about the situation John is in? You see, Christianity was not born in a vacuum. Christianity has not been weighed in the balances and found wanting. It's been tried, found difficult, and rejected. The Lord doesn't want your lousy sins. What do you think he does? Stock them in heaven? He wants you. He wants your personality. I've heard David use an illustration of seeing a car in New Zealand, a beautiful antique car on the side of the road, and the fellow says, I'll sell it for so much. He takes it home, gets the dirt off the outside, goes inside, takes out the seats, put in a vacuum, gets a stack of dust this height, calls his wife and says, darling, look what we've got on the kitchen table. That stack of muck. He said, I got it for $4,000. You what? $4,000? He said, I had to take that to get the car. The Lord has to take your lousy, rotten, twisted, perverted sin and rebellion to get you. He doesn't want your sin, he wants your personality. Just as you've been abandoned to the devil, you give him your body, your soul and spirit, abandon yourself to Christ. If we did that, we'd shake the world. You get off the hook from condemnation and guilt, and you've played around ever since, God help you. Do you know where the biggest prayer meetings in the world are today? You won't like this, but wait a minute, swallow it, it's true. This friend of mine who spoke in the Grand Hall in China this week, he went to the kings of Saudi Arabia, he went and spoke to Dan, what's the guy in Guatemala? Ortega, face to face. And Ortega said, Mister, come here, Mr. America, look. He took him in a room, and the wall was dark, and there were about 100 names, and nearly half of them were crossed out. And Ortega says, Mr. America, look there. You see those names? Every one of them is a personal friend of mine. And he choked up. He said, "Young, listen, Mr. America, the names that are crossed out, all those men have died for this country." And he says, "You will never win them. You Christians will never win Central America for Christ because you're afraid to die for him." He grew a beard because you cannot go into a mosque unless you have a beard. It's a sign, number one, that you're mature. Number two, it's your pledge to Allah that you'll die for him. And every mosque in the world is filled every morning. Do you know what happened in Saudi Arabia? The attendance at the 6 o'clock mass, as the Catholics would say, the 6 o'clock prayer meeting in the mosque, it took a nosedive. And the government had an inquiry about it. Dear God, what does our country, our Washington boys care about it? The government said, why are the mosques, hundreds of men are not coming? And they investigated, and that's where we found out the reason. Because American TV comes in at 6 o'clock with All In Wrestling. We've never seen it. Take the damnable thing away. They booted it all out. And once they did that, the prayer meetings got back to power. You call them terrorists. They're not terrorists. They're evangelists. They've touched the powers of the world to come. It's a strange power. It's a satanic power. There isn't one man of all the millions of Mohammedans in the world that wouldn't die tonight. God, die for Christ. We won't even live for him. You think you're going to heaven because you give God a tithe? Forget it. You can't give God a tithe of your time. He doesn't have your money. He says the tithe, you should give God a tenth of every day. You give him 2 hours and 24 minutes. Dear God, if you're in love, that's not long to be with somebody you love, 2 hours and 24 minutes. That's the legal thing. Then you give him an offering on top of that. You see, our young people haven't seen role models. I better rush on here a minute. What does it say about this fella here? Okay, we're in chapter 1 still. Verse 74. One of Luke, he said, Verse 24, that he will grant us that being delivered out of the hand of our enemies, we might serve him without fear. How? In holiness and righteousness. Righteousness is my relationship with the world. Holiness is my relationship with God. Don't blame the devil because your prayers aren't answered. It's your problem. You've got a problem in your house. It's a lousy, stinking thing. It'll kill you and your children. You'll love it. I'll tell you what it's called. It's called TV. You can call it terribly vicious or terribly vulgar or terribly anything else. But listen, don't you ask God to help you pull down the stronghold. Pull them down yourself. I have a friend and he was, I forget what country he was in, and there's some big monstrous bees, you know, that sting and really make you sick. And he was in bed and this thing's buzzing around his head. Oh, Lord, he said, send somebody to kill that thing. And it came past him, and he's fighting, half asleep, fighting. It goes. And he saw it hit toward a light, and he thought it got burned or something. And it went round again. So he says, Lord, kill the thing. And it suddenly hit the light above him and fell on his lap dead. And he said, God's sake, kill it yourself. You say, help me with my TV. Kill the thing. Throw it out. You know what happens when the wife goes to bed? The husband looks at stuff. He wouldn't look out when she's gone to bed. Then when she's out, he looks at stuff. He didn't tell her. Then when you're both out, the kids see it. The best way to help your son to hell, two ways, give him his own telephone in his bedroom, give him his own TV, and you'll see him go to perdition. Oh, somebody master TV, somebody needs to throw your bowling gear away. Somebody needs to throw your fishing gear away. Why? Can't preachers go fishing? Well, Peter did when he was backslidden. If you love fishing more than prayer, then fishing is your idol. If you love the bowling alley more than prayer, you love bowling, it's your idol. Just have an ordinary week next week. Take a notebook and keep the same program every day on TV. And at the end of the week, see how much time you spend in TV. And then keep a record of your praying. And I guarantee you give 3 hours or 4 hours or 5 hours for everyone you spend in prayer. And America's on the edge of disaster. We may avoid war with Russia. That old guy's skillful enough. But listen, if we go around that, we've got to go to Armageddon. And after Armageddon, there's a judgment seat, which is a billion times worse. I'll finish with that, hopefully. Maybe it's 7 a.m, but anyhow. Where were we? Still in the first chapter, that's tremendous. Verse 75, in holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our lives. And thou shalt be called the prophet of the highest, thou shalt go before the face of the Lord to give knowledge of the salvation to his people. Verse 78, through the tender mercy of our God, whereby the day star from on high has visited us, to give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet in the way. And then there's another verse that says what? He came to what? To turn the hearts of the fathers to the children. And that needs to be done. Some of you guys, you're more concerned about your Sunday school class than your own children. And that's wrong. It's totally wrong. Of course it's right. You think I'd tell if it was wrong? It's all right. I know his name's Frank. I didn't know that yesterday. But listen again. There isn't a revivalist. I told Wilkerson, standing in my office, David Wilkerson, I said, David, you've got 500 evangelists in America. You haven't one revivalist. You can't get Swaggart. He's gone off the map anyhow. You can't get James Robertson, anybody, to go to a city like Moody did. Moody came to England. He couldn't even speak English, like you. But I'm glad Bradley don't speak it. You understand it anyhow. It's a bit of a help. Well, they laughed at Moody, didn't you why? He said, Daniel, in one syllable, Daniel. He said, Jerusalem, in one slurring word, Jerusalem. Do you know what happened? He said, He stayed 6 weeks in London and the whole city was shaken. What happened? He preached an hour and somebody sang 10 minutes. Now you go to a gospel concert, they sing 60 minutes and preach 10. Forget it. He went to Scotland. The greatest preacher of the day was Alexander White. The next greatest preacher was Henry Drummond. He wrote that wonderful book, many of you read, The Greatest Thing in the World. And they sat spellbound listening to another Yankee that couldn't speak English. Why? There's a mystery about preaching. It's not burning eloquence and of shabby tears. Preaching is not a profession, it's a passion. It's not a passion, it's an obsession. I would rather preach than do anything in God's earth. It doesn't pay well, except today. There's a bucket at the door. No, I'm teasing about that. But, you know, one of the greatest preachers in the history of the world was John Owen. How many preachers there? Let me see your hands. Preachers or teachers. How many of you read John Owen ever? Good. He was a wonderful theologian. And he was vice chancellor of Oxford University. He knew his Hebrew and Greek and I don't know how many other languages. And every parliament that assembled, the King of England, who I believe at that time was Charles I, no Charles II, he always called Dr. Owen. We've got celebrities from all over the world. Preach a great sermon tonight in the cathedral. And people would go and say, Owen's preaching, you can't get in, it's stacked up. You can't sit on the floor, you can't get in by the wall. Owen's preaching. The king one day called Owen, Dr. Owen, come immediately. And Dr. Owen went. And he said, in his archaic English, the king said, where hast thou been? I hear that thou art listening to a babbling Baptist down the road by the name of John Bunyan. He's a tinker. He's never been ordained. He went to the same school as Milt, John 15. There's only one ordination. It's the ordination of the Holy Ghost. And here is a man who makes little kettles and bits of stuff during the day, preaching, and crowds are mobbing him. And here's this man, he says to the king, Your Majesty, if I could preach like that babbling Baptist, I would take off my robes and lay them at his feet. He has something I don't have. A diploma won't give you unction. A degree won't give you unction. You can't buy it. You buy it with grief. You buy it with your bankruptcy. Dear God, I've preached 66 years all over the world. And I tell God every time I come, I don't know anything. I'm weak. I have no strength. I have no confidence. My knees don't knock like they used to do, in the sense of physically being nervous. But I tremble at his word. I'm going to be judged at the judgment seat one day. By what? Your opinion? Forget it. By this word. Every word I've faced in this world is going to face me at the judgment seat. That's going to be an awful thing. Maybe sometime I'll come and I'll preach to you on that. It'll take 3 hours to preach on the judgment for preachers, the judgment for sinners, the judgment for believers. Yes, everybody loves gentle Jesus, meek and mild. Charles Wesley wrote 6,300 hymns, and his most popular hymn is Gentle Jesus, Meek and Mild. But also he wrote the hymn, Lo, he comes with clouds descending, once for favored sinners slain. Every eye shall then behold him, listen, clothed in dreadful majesty. When he came the first time, men pushed him around. When he comes the next time, he'll push men around. Read the second epistle to the Thessalonians, chapter 1. He's coming with awesome majesty. He's not stealing through the world, through the womb of a woman. He's coming with 10,000 saints. Maybe Milt will be leading the gang. That's the only reason I'd like to die quick. You know, the dead in Christ rise first. That's, so the dead in Christ are the Baptists, anyhow. The dead in Christ shall rise first. No Baptists here, all Christians. Let me tell you the atmosphere into which man came. Now in chapter 3, verse 1. In the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar. After all, remember, there's a Julius Caesar, Caligula. The best known was Julius Caesar. Tiberius Caesar was the most licentious. He propagated everything that was vile. He financially, by state money, supported everything immoral. And this man is on the throne. Now look at the rest of the chapter. Pontius Pilate was the governor of Judea. Herod being the tetrarch of Galilee. His brother Philip, the tetrarch of Ituria, in the region of Trachonitis. And Lysanias, the tetrarch of Abilene. Annas and Caiaphas. That's about as refreshing as a mouthful of sand, isn't it? But look at this. Annas and the high priest. You've not only got the Roman powers, Annas and the high priest. And it's illegal to have two high priests. So he comes on the stage. Where does he come? He doesn't come down Main Street. He's in the wilderness. The most difficult place in the world. When God wanted to lead Israel out of bondage, he had Moses lead them, and then were led by what you mentioned this morning, a pillar of fire. If God had put that pillar of fire in the wilderness, everybody would have flocked. He didn't put a pillar of fire there. He did more. He put a man on fire. This man from his infancy is baptized with the Holy Ghost. You people with the sweet bumper stickers helping people go to hell. You've got on one side of your car there, you've got a, what do you put on it? God loves you. Put on the other side. God is angry with the wicked every day. Forget your sloppy Christianity. Love is stronger than death. Our God is a consuming fire. There's no fire more terrible than the fire of love. And this man is absolutely inundated. He has no advantages. Dear God, he comes into the wilderness. There's no transport system to get people there. There's no hot dogs or anything you buy. There's no water following the people so they can drink. He's totally helpless. He has no disciples. He has no pillar of fire. He has no priests. He has no altar. He has no Bible. I can read on my knees, which I do mostly. I can read the 11th chapter of Hebrews. I can read that chapter. And every time I read it, talk about being slain in the spirit, I'm on the dust. What do you do? With a bunch of people, subdued kingdom, wrought righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouth of lions. Women received their dead raised to life again. I read it and the Lord said, read it again. I read it, the Lord said, read it again. And then as I read it, and he said, the voice said, and not one of them ever had a Bible. What are you going to do? You have the whole revelation of God. What are we going to do? Sure, I'm staggered when I read it. But what do I do when I come to that verse that says, some of them not accepting deliverance? They said it'll please God if we stay in jail 10 more years, we'll stay. You get into trouble, you have a trial, you get on the telephone, you call your relative. Oh, I'm having a rough time, pray for me. People say, pray God will take this off, forget it. God put it on you. What did the fire do for the three Hebrew children? They heated it 7 times more. They tried to starve them to death, and they were fairer and fatter on a rotten diet than the others were. But what happened? When they threw them into the fire, they tied their wrists and tied their feet. What happened? The fire burned off the fetters the world put on them. And sometimes God has to let circumstances break our fetters, burn our fetters off. Sure, as our sister said this morning, maybe you'd like a better husband or something. I was going to tease you until I was talking with Joyce's husband this afternoon. You say, what? You talk to the dead? No, I just preach to them. What do you mean you talk to a husband? Well, because it says in Isaiah that the Lord is your husband. That's why she's preaching so well these days. She's got a quickening from God. I rejoice in it, Joyce. And you're going to get more. So cheer up. Oh, well, let me just prove a point to you here. Do you know the difference between revival and evangelism? In evangelism, you have to stir people emotionally and sing a song. You know, like there's room at the cross for you, forget it. I will never sing that. I never have choruses when I make an appeal. I saw 100 men hit the deck. Do you know what they did the second day? They were side by side, doctors, all kinds of intellectual people, and they were saying this, help, 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 help. You think they were drowning or in a fire. But conviction does that, conviction of sin. The least work of the Holy Ghost that's emphasized today is conviction of sin. Boy, dear God, we expect to plow the field, sow the seed, and reap a harvest in half an hour. You don't get that in revival. Sure, the young man, I've been in Wales, I've met people who knew Evan Roberts. Evan Roberts had revival. He was 26 years of age, but wait a minute. At 26 years of age, he had already prayed 13 years for revival. When others played ball, when others went visiting, it didn't bother him a hoot. He was determined to get the prize that God had put before him. It didn't cost $1 million. You can have Robinson and Will Billy Graham and those guys spend $1 million a crusade. Revival doesn't cost anything. At broken hearts. You get to the place, I can't live. The reason we don't have revival in America is we're content to live without it. So you have children going to hell. When did you shed a tear over them? My dear wife says to me, Leonard, you get too much burn, you stay too long. I can't. Have you noticed it doesn't say Jesus was a man of tears? It says he was a man of sorrows. Sure, he's a man of tears. He prayed with strong crying and with tears. But you can pray tears occasionally. Sorrow is something you have. I liken it like this precious lady. It's not convenient at times to have that little bulge you have. You've got to carry with it 6 more weeks. Blessings. I hope it's not longer. But you know, it's the same with revival. You can't live until something's born. Christianity is life. It's not theology. What did Jesus say? I'm come that he might have life. What did he say in John's epistle? He that hath the Son hath what? Life. I don't care how big a man's head is, how big his fortune is. If he isn't born of God, he's dead. Ruskin, 100 years ago in England, said that preaching, I thought it was facetious. I chewed it over for 50 years and I found it wasn't. He said, preaching is 50 minutes to raise the dead. I thought that was a joke. I went to a big church not long ago, over 1,000 people. I said, every row there is death row. You're dead in trespass and in sin. You may wear $100 suit or $1,000 suit, have a $5,000 ring, but you're dead. Alive mentally, alive socially, alive emotionally, alive physically, but dead. You've no living communion with God. That's why you wonder why we clap and get happy sometimes. Because we're alive. We were dead in trespasses and in sin. We weren't just bad, we were dead. There are lots of people in the world that are better than Christians. I know some people who have more integrity and more honesty than Christians, and yet they're dead. They have high idealism. They were brought up with daddies and mummies that believe in the old virtues that America used to believe in. Anyhow, John Baptist comes to this situation. Again, listen, there's no pillar of fire. There's no dove upon his head. He has no altars. He has no sacrifice. He has no financial backing. Dear God, what's he going to do? Isn't it terrible when you've only God? You'll hardly believe this. Do you know he didn't even have a newsletter? Nobody raised funds for him. He was an evangelist. No, he's a revivalist. Evangelists raise funds. Revivalists raise hell. You go to a meeting when there's a breath of revival on it, you won't sleep. Some of you won't sleep tonight. I'll be driving home. Somebody else will drive us. But anyhow, I'll be praying all the way. Some of you won't sleep. You're better to have one sleepless night here than a million in hell. You're better to get a burden for your children who may be lusting and lying and cheating right now or mucking around with drugs. You're better to get down to business now. Do you know what the penalties of hell will be? The man in hell could see into the bosom of Abraham. That lost daughter of yours, that lost son of yours in hell will see you at the marriage supper of the Lamb and say, that's my daddy. He gave to missions. and he went to church, and he helped to take the offering, and he did a lot of nice things, but he never once said to me, darling, what were you doing last night for an hour or two? You came in at 1 o'clock. That's a rotten time to come. Do you ever check on your children? I stayed in a home. The woman never knew where her daughter was. She knew where her cat was. She'd say to the maid, a maid who always dressed up, you know, with a little thing on her head, and she'd say, well, dear Margaret, where is the cat? Lock the door. Don't let the dear cat. It's a thoroughbred pedigree. She'd give him $200 for a cat. I won't give you $200 for all the cats in America. But she knew you love dogs. But she knew where the cat was. She didn't know where her daughter was. I've had two tragedies this last week. Two of the most charming girls I could ever imagine. They both got pregnant. One's 14 and the other's 18. One of them, her daddy's a multimillionaire. He's got everything. She's had everything. He had time for business. He had time to read, take the, what do you call it, New York Times, and read the stocks and shares every day. And his daughter's going to hellfire. What will he do now? His family name is in the gutter. His wife paralyzed with fear. Our beautiful daughter, we bought her the richest clothes. We bought her the best of everything. And here she is now, as long as she lived. You know what she did? She had a baby and she murdered it. So the parents have double agony. The poor girl panicked. They say their mother never suspected that she had. She was in 9 months of pregnancy. I don't know how in the world she did that. But anyhow, that's what's happened. But you know what? I live in Smith County. At Tyler's in Smith County. There are 21 ministries round about us, and you know Smith County has the highest rate of 14-year-old pregnant girls in America. How does the devil set up business in the middle of meeting houses? Churches that profess to be filled with the Holy Ghost. The devil laughs at us. He doesn't laugh when there's a Holy Ghost revival. There's panic in hell. I love that phrase where some preacher are trying to drive demons out of, what, the sons of Sceva, trying to drive demons out of a man demon-possessed, and the devils have some respect. You know what they said? They said the greatest thing ever said, oh, God, I wish it was two of me. The demons wanted to stay and hold that person captive, and they looked up at the little half-deformed man who'd been stoned and his body broken, and they said, Jesus we know and Paul we know. Isn't that something? To be known in hell? There's not one preacher in 500, in 5,000 in America wants to be known in hell. They want to be known as the best preacher in their denomination. They want more money. To hell with it. Okay, we're in chapter 3 now, verse 6. I'm going to shut it down a bit in soon, a couple of hours anyhow. In verse 3 of chapter 3 it says, Annas Caiaphas, no, let me get to verse 3. He came into all the country about Jordan, preaching the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins, as it is written in the words of Isaiah, the prophet, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Isn't it amazing? Do you know who the loneliest men in the world? Prophets. God didn't say to Elijah, go to that other great, brilliant preacher that you have by the name of Elisha and pray with him. He says, go in a cave by yourself. I think you emphasized this morning, God said, I have called Abraham alone. He said, I've called Moses alone. Don't offer to be a prophet. It's a lonely business. It's a lonely business. If you really love somebody, you'll unburden them. And if God loves you and you get very intimate with God, he'll pour his burden on you. You say, my yoke is easy. Or you say, cast your burden on the Lord and he shall sustain. Who does he cast his burden on? He doesn't need to. He's omnipotent. He does. The prophets in the Old Testament, when they saw the sin of their nation, and God, it was a fraction like our sin, turned the century, We'll have the biggest dilemma we've ever had in history. It'll be worse than the bubonic plague, the way that AIDS is going. And now this new disease that come out, which is worse than AIDS, and it's travelling more quickly. And this new disease has come on, what do they call it, VHP or something, which is only transmitted by sexual contact, but it's more tragic and terrible than any other disease. We've got that. Plus the fact we've got the outrageous crime, what do you call it, plague in our history. I read a bunch of prophets last week. They called them. I said, don't ever call me a prophet. I'm not a prophet. I speak with prophetic urgency, prophetic anxiety. My nation's going to hell. This world's going to hell. Who's going to stop it? Nobody. You can't legislate righteousness. Dear God, those guys in Washington can't live straight themselves. How can they tell anybody else what to do? And dear God, we're not much better in the pulpit. People sneer now. Look at Jimmy Swagger. Look at PTL. So what? Let me tell you something very deeply. I never like to say that, it's as though you're not listening. Do you know what? If you're a true Christian and filled with the Holy Spirit, it's very difficult to sin. Swaggart says he battled with pornography for 3 years. That's a lie from hell. He didn't. He's telling me that the Holy Ghost didn't convict him. He's telling me he fought the Holy Ghost and won. You resist the Holy Ghost, you grieve the Holy Ghost, you resist the Holy Ghost, and then what? You quench the Holy Ghost. I know three men, and a man came in a gorgeous three-piece suit in my office, began to tell me he's burning with lust. I said, well, what's your problem? Are you married? Oh, yes, I've had two wives, and they got tired of sex, and I now have another woman I'm into. I said, brother, you need to go. He said, I'll ask God to help me. I said, he won't. Go to the cross. Take it to the cross. Nail the damnable thing down. Don't say, help me, I'm weak. Say, I'm vile. I almost preached tonight. I'll preach some other time if Joyce lets me come back. On Isaiah 6, what did Isaiah say when he saw the holiness of God? He said, what? I'm behind in my tithing. I'm behind in my prayers. No, he said, woe is me, I'm undone, I'm unclean. And he's a major prophet. You see, when the Holy Ghost comes and starts up digging up your life, I don't know why I thought of this, but this afternoon as I was meditating, I thought of the time I preached that great Methodist church in Dublin. They have a saying there, Dublin's fair city, where the girls are pretty. My precious wife comes from South Ireland. And I preached that night on the 51st Psalm, and God was present. I could tell you a lot of celebrities that were there, but I don't name drop. So anyhow, 3 years afterwards, I went to a conference in Northern Ireland, and a man said to me, do you remember me? I said, no, I don't. He said, you remember preaching on Psalm 51 in the great Methodist church in Ireland, you know, in, I forgot the street, in Dublin. I said, sure. He said, my wife and I, we're good Methodists. We tithe. We take communion. We help. We give to missions. We do everything we can do. But Mr. Ray, we're not saved. He said, we got home past midnight. And he said, we had a cup of tea and biscuits, as we say. I said, went to bed, and my wife sat on one side of the bed, I sat on the other, and we sat there for an hour. And he said, I said to my wife, why don't you go to sleep? And sweetly, you know, like wives do, she said, get to sleep yourself. And he said, I can't. Why can't you? Well, that fellow upset me tonight. When he was speaking, he saw a God touch my mind, a trap door open. I saw all my sins. Sins of youth, sins of manhood, sins of the flesh, sins of the spirit. They marched around the bedroom like an army. And he said, I got terrified. And he said, after an hour and a half, my wife got down at the side of the bed. She got up laughing and rejoicing. Why? I'm born again. I'm saved. I have the witness of the spirit. God now doesn't condemn me. He's cleansed me and lifted me. And he's living in me. Boy, he said, that made me angry. She got into bed. Left me to get rid of my load of sins. And I'm walking around the room tormented. She's ignoring, she's dreaming fairy tales. And he said, here I am going round. And finally he said, it suddenly hit me like that. He remembered that Martin Luther one day, he was in prison where Wittenberg, and he said, the devil got a record. And he said, he wrote all my sins on the wall. and he wrote them on the other wall, and he wrote them on the other wall, and he wrote them on the ceiling. And he said, go on, Satan, keep going, keep writing the sins. And he said, Satan said, there's nothing else to write. He said, there is. He said, there isn't. He said, there is. He said, your record is here. Every sin you've ever committed since you were a child is on record on the walls. There's nothing else to record. He said, there is. What shall I put on? He says, write over all of them. The blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us from all sin. If you had £100 weight on your back and somebody took it off, do you think you'd know? If you were in debt for $50,000 and somebody gave you $50,000, another $50 to spend, would you know? Well, sin is a burden. Sin is a disease. Sin is rebellion against God. When the fire goes out and the fire of the Holy Ghost comes in, it's a total transformation. Let me rush through this. So here this man's preaching his heart. Look what it says in verse 7. It says, the multitude came to be baptized. And this is nice language, isn't it? It says, oh, you generation of vipers. That's my, like me going in Westminster Abbey and say, you swine. You need to be saved. What do you think they'd do? Vote me the best man of the year? Not on your life. But listen, while he's pouring this, you see, this man is on fire. I used to say he has a tongue like the tail of a scorpion. I'll tell you what he had. He had a heart and a tongue like a laser beam. Every time he spoke, he left blisters on people's souls and minds. He dug up their past. They saw every damnable thing that was hindering them from coming to God. This message of salvation is not for bums and cripples, moral cripples, and folk that fill the prostitution places and read Playboy more than the Bible. It's for very fine fellows. Here's two of them, the greatest men in England, the most famous brothers maybe in England, John Wesley and Charles Wesley. And Charles Wesley was born again of the Spirit of God. How? His mother, his godly mother, gave him a copy of a book called The Life of God in the Soul of Man. Dear God, these men got up to pray at 4 o'clock in the morning, weren't even saved. They spent all night singing psalms. They were so anxious to find God. In one of his greatest hymns, and can it be that I should gain an interest in the Saviour's blood? He says in the second verse, a gentleman, a scholar, a man of impeccable morality. You couldn't find a thing wrong with his life. He gave alms to the poor. He built homes for the poor. He did every blessed thing he could to prove his love for humanity. And then he wrote this verse, long my imprisoned spirit lay fast bound in sin and nature's night. Thine eye diffused the quickening way. I woke, the dungeon flame with light. My chains fell off. If a man's chained, does he know when the chains go off? His chains had gone. He'd been imprisoned in what? Legality. Doing good works. Taking communion. Beating his body by fasting, and yet he never found the living Christ. But when he found him, do you know what he wrote later? All for a trumpet voice on all the world to call. But before he wrote that, he wrote this. My heart is full of Christ. Listen, not my head is full of theology. My heart is full of Christ and longs this glorious message to declare. No wonder he could say, honestly before God, thou, O Christ, art all I want. Is that true of you? Or do you want Christ plus something else? I'll tell you what Christianity is. Christianity is Christ plus nothing. He doesn't have to do wonderful things for me. He snatched me from hell. My body, soul, and spirit belongs to him. He gave his all for me. I give my all to him. Okay. We're going to rush on here a minute. Do you mind? Let's go to the second chapter. Where do we want to be now? Let's go to the second chapter in John. I think it's there I want to be. Remember Malachi said there's somebody coming, and who shall abide the day of his coming? Do you know the most dangerous place in the world? It's to be in a church where the Holy Ghost is in residence. You feel your uncleanness. You feel I'm vile. You wonder why God hasn't taken you off years ago. You've rebelled against him. You've vowed and you've broken your vows. You've made commitments and commitments and never kept them. And then you suddenly realize what a merciful God he is. Well, people began to ask this man, look at John chapter 1. This is the record, verse 19 of John. Listen, the Jews, the priests and the Levites came from Jerusalem. If you read the account in Matthew, it will tell you that they came from Judea and Samaria and everywhere. So John Baptist, without any sponsors, without any money, listen, the scripture clearly says John did no miracle. He never raised the dead man, he raised the dead nation. He didn't have any help. He wasn't name-dropping. He could have said, I come from one of the greatest families. My father's one of the best priests. He could have said, I have the best backing. I have an old lady, 100 years of age, by the name of Anna. Simeon is a personal friend of mine. I've got the greatest prayer people in the world. He didn't say that. All he cared was he had a commission and anointing from God. Look at verse 27 as I hurry. Oh, verse 26, John said, I baptize with water. There standeth among me one whom ye know not. He it is who coming after me is preferred before me, whose shoes I am not worthy to loose. Now, verse 29, the next day, notice that. Next day, John seeth Jesus coming unto him and saith, the most amazing thing. It's never been said before. It's never been said since in the history of the world. Like it was said of John, in front of him were the frowning Pharisees, on the other side were the scorning scribes, on the other side were the sad Sadducees, and he lifts his hand up, and he didn't know who it was. He said, I didn't know him, but the Lord said, in verse 32, jumping a minute here, or verse 31, I knew him not, but he should be made manifest to Israel. And verse 32 says, John bare record, saying, I saw the Spirit descending upon him like a dove. I knew him not. But he that sent me to baptize with water saith, upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending. Listen, and remaining upon him. You got filled with the Holy Ghost. Is he there tonight? Has he remained upon you? Has he brought forth all his fruits? Is he giving you energy? You say, I pray in tongues. Forget it. Don't literally forget it, but forget it. I'll tell you what. You say, I have a prayer language. The devil doesn't fear tongues or anything else. Sure, if you can't pray in English, maybe you pray in tongues. There's something far beyond tongues. Romans says there's praying which cannot be uttered. It has no language. It can't be vocal. I don't have to work myself up and beat my breast and worry there are 5 billion people without God or without hope. That the whole of Russia is one great hell game. The whole of China has 1 million gods and perversion. And Christianity can't penetrate it. What did Hannah do? She prayed, but her lips never moved. God is a spirit, I'm a spirit. You can pray with eloquent words and God will ignore you. Because it's not your spirit that's praying. It's not your passion that's praying. It's not your vision that's praying. You're trying to get rid of the load. We're going to have prayer meetings when there's groanings which cannot be uttered. Prayer meetings where you won't want to go. And when you get in, you won't want to go out. Such prayer meetings have been in every revival. But let me go back a moment. See this man. There are two kinds of people watching him. You say, no, there are three. I say there are two. The scripture says there are three. Well, I say there are two. Are you overriding the scripture? No, I'm putting them together like this. Hey, Jews and the others were there. There are two kinds of people watching John the Baptist. This group is amazed and that group is amused. Who is this guy? He talks about God as though he talks with him day by day. He has no altar. He has no priest. He has no sacrifice. Who is he? Where's he from? And look what he's wearing. A pair of old dirty leather shorts. He used to have a camel, but he killed it. He traveled on it so far. So he skinned it and he wears it for a shirt. A smelly old shirt. John the Baptist. Without a clerical collar. without a degree, shaking hell. The Jews are coming, the Pharisees are coming. You never can have, you never have to advertise a fire. I remember going home one night, dashed upstairs, and Martha, darling, there's a fire up in town. We live in a town, there are lots of mills. And, you know, I got in that little car, said, Sweetie, we'll stay a few minutes. And we went up a street, and I thought, boy, I'll get within a, you know, I'll get a front seat. Everybody in town thought that. There are about 500 people in front of us. So I turned the car, I went to the next street. And as I went down, the heat was so great, I couldn't get near it. Everybody was there. People that don't get up at 2 and 3 in the morning were standing there. We watched the thing burn. We watched girders this depth, the cross beams of iron twist as though they were made of putty. The fire was there. The Spirit descended on Jesus a dove. He didn't need the fire of the Holy Ghost to cleanse him. The Spirit is a lovely bird. Upon me, the dove. It marries only once. It has 9 wings, 9 feathers on one wing, and it has 9 feathers on the other, 9 gifts and 9 fruits. And the Holy Spirit is like that. Nor put the dove after the window. The raven, poor old raven's a carnivorous bird. It eats junk. The dove went out, couldn't find anywhere to rest, so he went back. He's going to settle on the carcass. No, it stinks. If the dove, do you know why? You've no nothing in your church. The Holy Spirit comes and he smells death there every Sunday, so he goes off. Comes to your life and he smells death, so off he goes. Those men were totally in despair. They'd seen the greatest failure in the world, so they thought. And yet, Jesus is risen. And he says, tarry, see, re-endure. Okay, let's hurry. So you see, the two greatest forces in the world, fire and wind together. Do you remember last year, that great fire on the West Coast? They said, we have it under control. The next morning, they said, the wind got up and started off. It's worse than ever. You can't resist the Holy Spirit of God when the fire really breaks. But listen, let me say this again. He stands there, maybe puts his hands up. And he said, behold, the Lamb of God. What did that mean? It meant to those priests, your priesthood is bankrupt. It's obnoxious. Your performance, well, your priesthood is obsolete and obnoxious. Listen to what he says. Behold, the Lamb of Israel, no, the Lamb of God, that taketh away the sin of the world. That echoed down every corridor in hell. Every one of those men was shaken to his roots. I've lost my job. Isaac Watts wrote the greatest hymns. He wrote, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. He also wrote the hymn, Am I a Soldier of the Cross? He also wrote the Christmas song, Joy to the World, the Lord is Come. But he also wrote a hymn, Not all the blood of beasts on Jewish altars slain could give one guilty conscience peace or wash away one stain, but Christ, the heavenly Lamb. Have you ever thought the millions of sins being committed today that can be forgiven by one drop of blood of Jesus? He doesn't have to be re-crucified. Once in the end of the age he appeared. By one man's sin entered into the world and by one man's sin's problem was solved. Sure, the devil opened the floodgates of hell on the world, but Jesus Christ made a perfect atonement. There remains no more sacrifice for sin. Every mass tomorrow is idolatry to God. Jesus made a perfect offering, but listen, let me tell you what I believe. I believe as John looked there at that multitude, he was looking three ways. He was looking backwards. I'm not sure, I think it's in Revelation 10. What does it say there? He says, well, let me go back on myself a minute here. You find twice in this chapter, look, in verse 30, the next day, John seeth Jesus coming. Behold, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. Look at verse 36, no, verse 35. Again, the next day. Now, you work on those two next days. Did not happen in between? In between him saying, Behold, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world, Jesus went into the wilderness, was tempted. That's why John didn't know him. When he went into that temptation, he looked 30 years of age. When he came out, he looked 50. You can't bear the sin of the world. You can't bear the judgment of God and retain your body. The Lord will take, it'll take a penalty on your body, on your mind. You can't live for Christ and eat three meals a day and sleep 9 hours at night in a world that's going to hell fire. You see, we've lost the fire. Our priests have lost the fire. Our praying has lost its fire. Our passion has lost its fire. Okay, let me go on to this. He doesn't say the second time here, or verse 36. Looking on Jesus, said, behold the Lamb of God. Look, let me say this quickly. I believe he was looking back to see the Lamb slain from, not before, the foundation of the world. As soon as man sinned, God inaugurated a rescue system. But not only that, he's looking to the end of the age. To use an old American hymn, when all of life is over and our work on earth is done, what are you going to see? Only twice, John, not John the Baptist, John the Evangelist, one of the most brilliant men that ever lived. It's the most beautiful thing in English prose, John's Gospel. But listen, do you remember John and Peter healed a man at the gate of the temple? And then they dragged him into the court. What did the court king say? He said, that's Peter, that's John. They're unlearned and ignorant men. It was an unlearned man that wrote the Gospel of John. It was an uneducated man that wrote the first epistle of John, the second epistle of John, the third epistle of John. And then to prove his ignorance, he wrote the book of the Revelation. Dear God, if that's ignorance, I want two doses of it right now. He not only sees the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world, he not only sees the possibility of every depraved human being, whether they're yellow, black or white, saved, but he goes to the end of time. And there in eternity, he says, what does he see in the midst of the throne? The old rugged cross? No. The sandals of the Virgin Mary? No. What does he say? I saw in the midst of the throne a lamb, as it had been slain. The 24 and 20 elders fell down when the lamb came. What did they do? They worshipped God and they overcame every sin. They overcame every government. They overcame every scaffolding on which they hung. They overcame every grave through what? The blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. The blood has to come back. We're not preaching the cross. We're preaching drugs. We're preaching divorce. We're preaching drinking. We're preaching abortion. Forget it. Those things have come. The sin of America tonight, our jails are filled, our divorce courts. Do you know whose fault it is? It's not the devil's fault, it's the preacher's fault. We've been afraid of deacons and other. For God's sake, get rid of them. Get rid of the fear of man. You're going to stand at the judgment before very long. What will you do? You can't lean on your wife or a friend? Forget it. Well, I'm nearly through. Don't get too anxious. Look at the Gospel of Luke for a minute. Would you do that? Chapter 12. Why did Jesus come into the world? To save sinners. Forget that. Forget what the Apostle Paul said about it. Forget what Luke said about it. Forget what John said about it. Here it is in the very words of Jesus. Why does it say in Luke chapter 12? And verse 49, I am come to send fire on earth. Do you hear that? Verse 41, suppose ye I am come to give peace on earth. I tell you, no, I came to bring division. I come to divide the house, the father against the son against the father, the mother against the daughter. You know, when you get Jesus in the home, you'll get 10 times more trouble than you've ever had in your life. Everybody will oppose you. You can live like a saint. Jesus lived as the most saintly man in the world, and they scorned him, and they said, we were not born of fornication. In other words, they said, you're a bastard. Do you like that? Are you prepared to bear reproach for Christ's sake? He didn't come to bring peace. He came to bring a sword. Let me use it there again. I'm come to send fire on earth. Do you remember that first book that Billy Graham wrote, World Aflame? It was a bestseller. He mentions all the texts on fire. He never mentions this one. I've come to bring fire on earth. Some of you men read, any of you read Bonhoeffer? What was his book? The Cost of Discipleship. He quotes hundreds of texts. He never quotes this text. Shoemaker was a great preacher when I came to America, and he wrote a book, The Incendiary Fellowship. He never mentions this text. Why? We're afraid of fire. And yet the book of Revelation says, our God is a consuming fire. I'm going to wrap this up quickly. In the book of Genesis, you have fire, flaming sword, so they couldn't get back into the Garden of Eden. In the book of the Revelation, you have fire. Charles Wesley, to bring fire on earth am I come. Charles Wesley has a hymn in which he says, how does it start? Well, he has one anyhow. I'll quote another one of his. Come, Jesus, Lord, with holy fire. Come and my quickened heart inspire. Cleansed in thy precious blood. Now to my soul thyself reveal. Thy mighty working let me feel. Since I am born of God. He says, I came to bring fire on earth. Let me get hold of that. What's that hymn? Oh, Wesley's hymn was this, see how great a flame aspires, kindled by a spark of grace. Jesus love the nation fires, sets the kingdoms on a blaze. To bring fire on earth he came, kindled in some hearts it is. Oh, that all might catch the flame, all partake the glorious bliss. When he first the work began, small and feeble was his frame. Now the word doth swiftly run, now it wins its widening way. More and more it spreads and grows, ever mighty to prevail. Since strongholds it overflows. Do you know why our preachers can't beat victory? The verse are not in victory themselves. What are you burning with just now? Hatred, bitterness, anger, pride, lust? Lust for a woman, or lust for pleasure, or lust for fame, or lust for preeminence? What are you burning with? There's only one answer to that, and that's the fire of the Holy Ghost. When he comes, he purges the heart. Is there anything purges more than fire? Doesn't Malachi say he sits at the refiner's fire? Do you know what a man does to purify gold? He sits there, he gets a bar of gold, he puts it in an induction, what do you call it, an induction crucible. He presses some buttons and the gold begins to melt, and he does that and throws it away. What's he throwing away? The scum off the top. He throws another lot away, he throws another lot away, he throws another lot away. And then you say, why didn't you take some off? I won't take it. Why not? Because I can see myself. Immediately gold is purified. It reflects the image of the one who did it. You played for us yesterday, sister. What was it? Let the beauty of Jesus be seen in me. Did you mean it? Oh, thou spirit divine, all my nature refine, till the beauty of Jesus be seen in me. It's a process. It's painful. He starts taking away the things I want that he can use. But they're not pure. Your heart isn't pure. Your motive isn't pure. Your desire isn't pure. And therefore you're killing your own prayer. I preached in Ireland. Behind me was a picture of a woman. A book has just been written about her. Amy Wilson Carmichael. It's written by a great woman, Elizabeth Elliot. Buy it. You'll read about that woman. She got a single ticket from Ireland to India. And she built orphanages. And boy, our dear Paul in South America is a superman in my judgment. He's never asked me for a penny. We're a crazy family. I don't have a regular income. My two sons don't have it. We've no newsletter. We never ask for money. Our policies, we never ask for it. We never refuse it. And we've got sons that have never asked for a dime. Our son left the largest Pentecostal church in New Zealand. He's been pastor there for 15 years and conducted the Bible school. And God told him to come back to America. People promised to open doors last year. They didn't. And he was groveling for pennies. He's preaching for John Wimber tonight out there in California. I'm just telling you, Frank, don't get discouraged. If God's on your side, does it matter who's against us? If God be for us, who'll be against us? All hell. After all, when, what was it, fell from heaven, Satan, he took a third part of the heavenly host. So there are two-thirds on my side, plus the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, and two-thirds of them. Oh, I'm victory in already. More than conquerors through him. All right, so this precious little Irish woman wrote this. And remember, she weighs about 100 pounds. All the years she was in Africa, she had a curvature of the spine. The last 3 years she was there, they lifted her in and out of bed every day of her life. And this is what she wrote. This little shriveled up woman, give me a love that leads the way, a faith which nothing can dismay, a hope no disappointments tire, a passion that will burn like fire. Let me not sink to be a clod. What good is she on a sick bed? She's writing some of the most marvellous things ever penned. We give the men the glitter and the glamour. As I left the meeting the other day, a little Japanese lady, she said, I speak to you. I said, go ahead. I speak to you. I said, well, go ahead. She said, I listened to your tape. You preach strong when you were here 2 months ago. You speak, I speak, I said, go ahead. Come on, get it over. What is it? She said, you said, if somebody would open a house of prayer, I'd come and live in Kansas and join the prayer team. She said, well, I give you my motel. Oh, mercy. Didn't I want to repent right away? I said, what do you mean? I give you my motel. It's a beautiful motel. I give you. Turn it into a house of prayer. I said, I don't need a motel, lady. But that precious lady was willing to give that. Then I was talking to all nations. Here's a little Chinese. I speak to you. Oh, yes. Japanese lady, I speak to you. Chinaman, I speak to you. And what do you want? He said, well, in China, so many years ago, a lady, there's a lovely English lady there. Well, all English ladies are lovely anyhow. So anyhow, I'm going to run out of this. Doesn't taste nice. Listen to what he said. Mr. Ravenhill, he said, whatever that means. Mr. Ravenhill, he said, this lady in England came to China, very, very charming lady, very talented lady, and she said, she was 30 years of age, I will not teach anybody over 30. I will work with people under 30. And then she said, I will work with people now around 15. And the tears filled his eyes. Mr. Ravenhill, that little lady had hardly any money, and she lived like the Chinese. She got 20 young people around her. And out of the 20, 10 of them became leading spiritual powers in China. And one of them more spiritual. Do you know who that was? I couldn't guess. Watchman Nee. He's blessed the world. Because one woman, they want to evangelize the world. She says the potential. You want to be a preacher, work on your kids, your children, I mean. Since you're not goats, you can't have kids. People ask me if I need kids. I say, no, they've no goats. Children, precious gifts from God. How do you know your child isn't another John Wesley? Okay, let me give you another one. There's a woman in England again. She said, I'm tired of going to church, standing up, sitting down, giving the offering. I'm tired. It's ritual. It's boring. What shall I do? The Lord said, go down to Tilbury Docks in London, get on a boat, and wherever the boat stops, gets off. So she stayed on the boat week after week after week after week. It was a poor tramp steamer, freighter, very slow. It's like trying to do the Indy 500 on a skateboard. So she's going across the Atlantic, the mighty Atlantic, 3,000 miles from England to New York. Bypass that. They didn't go to New York. Where did the boat stop after weeks? It stopped in Hong Kong. In Hong Kong, there's a wall in the middle of the city, and the old British colony is in that wall. But now, do you know who live there? The Chinese mafia. Is Oral Roberts going to have a crusade there? No. Billy Graham? No. Robertson? No. There's not enough money in it. So a precious little woman is working inside those walls, and she's working with the Chinese mafia, and she has some of the most outstanding conversions that have been through Christianity in 100 years. She doesn't write a book. She doesn't beg for money. Some of you school teachers, some of you lawyers. I was telling about the young team, let me finish up. The team up there in Kansas City, the man gave up a $200,000 a year job last year to take $18,000. Another one has a Fulbright scholarship. Another one has vast wealth. A man came from Africa because he heard of a church where they prayed 2 hours in the morning, two in the afternoon, two at night. And you see, fire begets fire. Fire attracts. When William Booth got the blessed message of full salvation, and remember he wrote the battle hymn, I'll say two things, the battle hymn of the Salvation Army, Thou Christ of burning, cleansing flame, send the fire. Thy blood-bought gift tonight we claim, send the fire. Look down and see this waiting host. Give us the promised Holy Ghost. We want another Pentecost. I don't know whether we want one, we need one. We need a Pentecost to our Pentecost, Pentecost. Pentecost stinks to people now through Swaggerton PTL, but God will redeem it through some holy men and holy women, and it will start in your house. When they see you instead of watching TV, you read more of the Word, you're praying. Mummy, why do you cry? Well, darling, because your daddy's lost. He's a good man, but he's lost. Your Aunt Mary's lost. Your grandfather's lost. Why have you suddenly got concerned? Oh, I've been asleep all this time. I got the baptism of the Holy Ghost the other night, and every bit of dross was burned up in me. Okay. Who is Jesus coming for? Tell me. A bride. Okay. The young princes in England all want to get married in Westminster Abbey. They put on a naval suit with big gold buttons. They carry a sword with a gold handle. The abbey. Only 3,000 people can go. The greatest people in the earth. Kings, rulers, presidents, geniuses, artists. Only they can go in. It's by ticket only, very strictly. 3,000 people. Up in the organ loft, like this is the altar where the bride is to come. And up there, high up, there's an organ loft. The organist says, sir, how will I know when to pump? You know, here comes the bride. Here. I'll tell you what, at the door, there's a fanfare of trumpets. There are six men there in their robes, and they have their trumpets, and they'll blast. And as soon as they blast, you announce, here comes the bride. So here's the bridegroom standing at the altar, all dressed up. Everybody's saying, the young prince, isn't he handsome? Look at the beautiful things he's wearing. And suddenly, when the organ says, here comes the bride, a woman comes through the door. She's stark naked. She stinks. She hasn't been bathed. Her hair's flying in the breeze. She runs into a pew and her leg is cut and it's all bloody. She gets down to help her legs and then rubs it on herself. She's weak. She's bloody. And a soldier comes and goes, what are you doing here? She said, I'm the bride. You idiot. You stink. She's blind. She's unwashed. She's brainless almost. And she claims she's the bride to this brilliant young man who has 4 or 5... Like Prince Charles speaks 4 or 5 languages. He's commanded a ship at sea. He's a very qualified fighter pilot. He has everything a prince can have. And this dirty harlot, stinking woman, unclean, is claiming she's the bride of that young man. What do? They throw her out. You tell me that Jesus Christ is coming for a bride like that? The world is scorning Christianity. But wait, I'm through. 2 minutes, I hope. Listen. I'd love to write sometime on the majesty of the Holy Ghost. As dear sister said, that we talk about him so flippantly. Do you ever think when Jesus was in the body of Mary, before that Isaiah 6, angels and cherubim fell down and worshipped him and praised him. And then out of the blinding glory of heaven, he's shut up in a woman's belly for 9 months. Where there's no music. Where there's nobody to talk to, nobody to see. And there he is, a prisoner who made heaven and earth. But she was conceived by the Holy Ghost. He was conceived by the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost made the world in which I live. The Holy Ghost came on some powerless, poor, pitiable men in the upper room. And they went out and turned the world upside down. Tell me. I had a theologian in. I get everybody from all over the earth. I had a theologian, a Pentecostal theologian in my office recently. I said, I've just been reading for the umpteenth time that book on the Azusa Street. It says on the first page there that in the world today there are 70 million Pentecostal people. I said, you're a theologian. Tell me this. Classical Pentecostals. I said, does that mean they're filled with the Holy Ghost and speak in tongues? I said, yes. Well, he said, but it's not so. There aren't 70 million. I said, well, it says in the book. The book is 5 years old. He said, Mr. Ravenhill, there are 120 million people in the world filled with the Holy Ghost and speaking in tongues. I reached up and then he stuck my finger in his eye. I said, sir, were there 120 million in the upper room? Oh, no. Well, I said, in God's name, what's the difference between your Pentecostal baptism and theirs? It's a shibboleth. There's a false Pentecostalism. Tell them you hear it here. I don't care. They won't let me on the platform. I have to answer to God before long. Can you have a world in this rotten, stinking state? Why is everybody scorning Swaggart and others? I'll tell you why. Because Jesus said when the salt has lost its savour, men will trample it underfoot. And they're trampling underfoot now with no power. It's a shibboleth. Who cares, ale or beans, about speaking in tongues if your daughters are going to hell? If your pastors are drinking wine and reading Playboy and doing all the lousy things they did. Savonarola turned Florence upside down. There was no gift of tongues. William Booth sent the Salvation Army into 70 countries in 90 years. They had the baptism of the Spirit and they didn't bother about tongues. Wesley turned the world upside down. And he talked about a sanctified life, a holy sanctified life. Let me say this and quit. I will say two things. When we were driving home the other day from Kansas, my wife said to this fine young businessman, he'd given up his career in business. His daddy's worked all his life to amass a fortune. First of all, his daddy was grieved he didn't marry a Greek girl. He's a Greek. Secondly, he got married. He wouldn't go to a Greek church to get married. And something else he did, and he fell into real disfavor with his daddy. So Martha said, well, your wife will be lonely today. And he said, no, Miss Martha, my wife won't be lonely. He said, last year I went to Guatemala with 20 young people from our church, and we went to see what it was like there, to see the poverty and the need. And he said, when I got back, I just knocked on the door. I didn't ring the bell. My wife opened the door, and her face was radiant. He said, darling, what happened to you? She said, when you left 2 weeks ago, I locked the door. I haven't drunk. I've not eaten a bite of food for 14 days. I've drunk water. And I said to God, now, God, I want you to sanctify me according to 1 Thessalonians 5:23, my spirit, soul, and body. Next verse, faithful is he that calleth you also will do it. And she said, I said, sanctify me, spirit, soul, and body. And the Lord said, I'll do that for you. He said, right now we'll start. Take your shorts, take your bathing suits, take all your makeup and burn it. That's how you start. Come on. The king's daughter's all beautiful within. Don't die every day. Tell God he didn't make me good enough. You go to the chemist and get a new face. Forget it. Put it down the sink at night where it should go. But she said, I didn't think it'd start like that. But she said, I can't tell you the joy I have. He gives the Holy Spirit to them that obey him. Not 10 years ago, but every moment you obey him. The Spirit will control. And when you don't do that, keep up the performance, speak in tongues, try and do some miracle, and everybody knows it's empty. Okay, here we are. Supposing I say, there's a lady in this audience tonight, she's one of the richest women in America, she never buys a dress over less than $1,000, she's got rings worth $250,000 like Elizabeth Taylor, she has a mansion, she has yachts, she has everything. Lady, come forward, will you, please? I want these people to take your photograph. So she poses, you know, like ladies can. and says this dress was handmade in Paris. It cost $8,000. I have 10 of them. And she tells you shoes are made somewhere else in Italy, and they cost $1,000. She goes on with all her gear. And then while they're taking a picture, there's somebody there has a camera that shines right through her clothing and her body into her heart. And you see streaks of yellow, which means jealousy. You see streaks of blackness, which means pride. You see streaks of bitterness. God is taking a photograph, as he did of the church. His quarrel with the church today is she's poor, wretched, naked, blind and miserable. That's not the critics of New York Times, it's Jesus. Sing about the church that he bled for. With his own blood he bought her, and for her life he died. And she's in this rotten, stinking mess now. Poor, wretched, naked, blind. Blind to the 5 billion people that are lost. Blind to the judgment seat. Blind to her own uncleanness. Blind to her own blindness. Blind to the pride in her heart. Pride is the last thing to leave the human heart, the first thing to get back. Okay, she's painted a picture of herself as a woman with wavy hair, gorgeous teeth, blue eyes. As the Bible talks about, a neck like a pillar of marble, teeth like sheep that have come up from the washing. She's every queenly quality. And she writes underneath, I am rich and increased in goods, I have need of nothing. And while she's painting herself, somebody else paints a picture, and instead of a lady with gorgeous wavy hair, he paints a bald head. Instead of lovely white teeth, her teeth are yellow with decay. Instead of rosy cheeks, her cheeks look rotten. And the one that there that saw herself said, I'm rich and increased in goods, I have need of nothing. And God says of the same person, you're naked, wretched, blind and poor and miserable. Tell me this. You say you're part of the bride. Would you like to die tonight without having a chance to repent? Without going to somebody and saying you're sorry? Without going to God and saying I'm lazy? I have no prayer life. I'm blind to the lost. I'm blind to the horrors of hell. I got out of bed one morning, staggered over to my bedroom, to my office at the other end of the house. I began to read the Revelation 20, and I went over and over twice or three times. What does it say? It talks about the second death. You've heard sermons on the second birth, on the second coming, on the second blessing. You ever hear one on the second death? And I just pushed my chair back as I read that. And I turned, I was sure a voice said to me, hell has no exits. A million ways into hell. The road your husband's on, the broad way. The children on the way. You've no tears, you're blind. I tell you, it's an awful thing to become alive in Jesus Christ. Every part of us becomes alive. Our compassion, our burden. Dear God, I felt like ourselves. I feel like now, I'd love to go away for a month and be quiet. I'm 5 years behind on a book that's burning in me, the judgment seat of Christ. Let me say this. Friend, you're going to the judgment seat not to have your passport checked. You're going to have your baggage checked. What have you been carrying all your life? When God takes the wrappings off you, your self-opinion, your self-righteousness, your self-seeking, you're stark naked. What's he going to find? You're not going to be judged for how many souls you won, how many servants you preach. You're going to be judged for how like Christ you are. I slip in the back door and say, does your daddy go to church? Yes, he's a deacon. I say, is he like Jesus? Oh, no, he gets furious. He gets mad. He talks badly to mummy. She cries. Come on. Are you like Christ in the home? I don't care how well you preach. I don't care how many countries you've traveled. I've traveled in stacks of countries. When the Lord showed me my precious Martha is part of the bride, how do you think I'd handle the bride of Jesus Christ? That's why I handle Martha. That's why I give her a hug every day. Darling, you're beautiful. I love you. Because she means so much. Come on now. Could you go into the presence of Jesus tonight? If you say you believe Jesus may come at any moment, it means this. You're pure in heart. You've no bitterness. You've no anger. You've no wrath. You've no sourness. You've no self-righteousness, you've no self-interest, no self-seeking. True love does its utmost to supply the utmost love for the one it loves. The only way you can love Jesus is to love him with all your heart, soul, mind and strength. He shall baptize you. Has he done it? and the spirit remaining, I won't let the fire go out in my heart. My darling will say sometimes, Len, with somebody coming tonight, I say, well, sweetheart, I'll stay half an hour. They may be offended. I'd rather offend them than God. I talk maybe 20 minutes. I get up and go in my office and stay 3 or 4 hours. I don't have an obligation to people, except in a very courteous way, but they run my life. We get 35 visitors a week. If I give them an hour, that's 35 hours gone. I won't give it. They come for every reason under the sun. But I'm telling you tonight, Jesus Christ is weeping. And he'll be weeping till he comes. He's not weeping over a lost world. He's not weeping over Sodom. He's not weeping over a hellhole called New York. He's not weeping over a country city called Singapore. He's weeping over the church. She's dirty. She's dirty with pride. She's dirty with uncleanness. She's dirty with anger. She's dirty with sloth. And there's only one way of cleansing. 1 minute. When you see a picture of the cross, you see a cross like that. Isaac Watts wrote the hymn, When I Survey the Wondrous... This is how he wrote it. When I survey the wondrous cross where the young Prince of Glory died. And when they crucified him, he didn't have a stitch on him. He was stark naked. That's part of the humiliation. The last verse of that hymn, you can't find it in any hymn book. Every time we get new hymn books, we cut verses out. The last verse is this. His dying crimson like a robe spread o'er his body on the tree. Then am I dead to all the globe, and all the globe is dead to me. You may not remember the day you get saved. I tell you what, if you let Christ crucify you tonight, you'll remember it from here to eternity. All right, there's a cross like that. There's a cross like a letter T, where a man's head was allowed to go back. There's a cross that was merely a tree with a big spike, and they put a man on it and turned him round. The worst crucifixion was not a crucifixion, even like Jesus. It was when a man had killed another man, they took the corpse, put it on the floor, and they tied the murderer to the murdered person. And then they stood him up, and he has to walk everywhere with a corpse. He wakes up in the morning looking into glassy eyes of death. He goes on day by day. The stink of the corpse comes into him, and he staggers round. And he says, oh, wretched man that I am, will you deliver me? You're my friend. No, I can't. According to Roman law, if you cut that body from that man, you have to have the body tied to you. So Paul finishes in Romans 7, and the lying preachers say he died there. He didn't. You can't have an indwelling spirit of evil and have an indwelling Christ on Galatians 2:20. Not I, but Christ liveth in me. In Romans 7, he says, it's not I, it's sin that dwelleth in me. O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me? Can the law do it? No. Can good works do it? No. O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me? He says, thanks God through Jesus Christ my Lord. Because you see, your old nature was taken to the cross with Jesus. Read Romans 6. If you get into water like that, you stand up, you get baptized, you go under the water, you can't see the world above, you can't talk to it, you can't communicate. If you get buried with Christ, you won't want the stinking world. You want to watch silly, stupid TV. You won't itch to get out of church Sunday morning and then spend 3 hours Sunday afternoon watching football. Listen, Christ wants everything in you or nothing. I would dare to say that Christ tonight doesn't care whether you go to hell or not. For the simple reason, he's made every convenience for you to go to heaven. Not to be holy when you get there, but to be holy now. As he which hath called you is holy. Didn't you sing about holiness in the hymns tonight? I almost had you sing that great hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy Lord God Almighty. Come on, what about the uncleanness? You going to get rid of it? Are you going to get rid of that body of sin, that filthy pride, that greed, that lust? It'll kill you. God says to Saul of Tarsus, kill the Amalekites. He didn't. So what happened? They killed him. You say, put his sword up. Sure he did. He propped his sword up like that and he fell on it. And it didn't kill him. He looked up and there's a charming young man. Who are you? I'm an Amalekite. And he killed the king. The king should have killed him. That sin will cripple your life and kill you. If it doesn't kill you physically, it will make you useless to God. What good are you as a deacon? You're not a praying man. You have no qualification. You should be filled with the Holy Ghost. You should be filled with compassion. You should be filled with love. And that's not true for them. Unless this generation sees a generation of holy people who go to hell and gnash its teeth forever at the failure of God. Well, it's not going to do that in my life and my precious Martha and children. If you get cleaned up, your family will get cleaned up. Quit lecturing them. Tell them, I'm starting a prayer life. I'm starting praying. I'm starting interceding. I'm not bothering with the fashion of the world, the style of our clothes, the style you do your hair. I'm going to live for Jesus. I don't totally know what it means, but I've been pondering it this week. Paul says, I want to be filled, not with God, with all the fullness of God. Filled. So there's no room for anything else in my heart but God. No room for pleasure. No room for this world, its customs. Just Christ, all in all. I very often said to people, come forward and I'll pray for you. I won't do that. I'm not going to sing some emotional folk song to get you down here weeping. I'm going to ask you, if you mean business with God, go home, get a sheet of paper, clean sheet, put your name on top, put the date on top, then write out what you know is wrong with your life. I'm lazy, I'm indifferent to the lost, I have no compassion, I have no vision, life has no power. Go down the list. And then put a line underneath and say, Lord, you show me what's wrong. You'll be amazed what he shows you. Things that offend him in your life. You're not always truthful. You're very erratic in your reading of the word. You're very inconsiderate of the lost. And then put it down, stick your name on it and say, Lord, tonight I want to be crucified with Christ. Put to death everything in me that's unholy and fill me as full as a human being can be with the Holy Spirit of God. And if you live, if it fills you with the Holy Spirit, you'll have a holy life. You'll have holy language. It doesn't necessarily mean in tongues. It means you'll be pure. You'll be uncritical. It's interesting. There were tongues of fire in the upper room because in the third chapter of James, it says the tongue of a man is uncontrollable. If you can control your tongue, it says you're a perfect man. But a tongue that's been a lying tongue becomes a truthful tongue. It becomes a holy tongue. And I make God happy. You can't make him rich. He owns the world. The only way you can make God happy is living a Christ-like life with victory over sin and joy in the Holy Ghost. Don't do it because somebody else does it. I'm going to be praying as we drive home. I'm going to ask you tonight. And you're not making a covenant with me, oh dear Joyce here. You're making a covenant with God. I'm going to get rid of this bondage tonight, whatever it costs. We say, come and live. Jesus says, come and die. Take up your cross. You knew this. If a man was going out with a cross, he wasn't coming back. And as soon as he nailed to the cross, he had no rights. Lose all your rights. Your right to criticize. Your right to be a failure. The right to be dry-eyed. Say, God, I must be filled with yourself. I want to be a true Bible Christian. Are you going to make that vow? If so, stand as a pledge that you'll do it. And then go home and do it. Now pray and close the meeting. Are you going to meet God tonight? Father, I thank you tonight that while the world outside is drinking and sinning and lusting, you've given these precious people a desire for God. And you said, blessed are they who hunger and thirst. Lord, I pray that some people here may go to their own funeral tonight, really die to sin and to self, die to failure, and take Christ in his fullness, take the Holy Spirit to come and work his purpose in their lives. Lord, bless them. Bless the preachers here. Bless the Sunday school teachers. Bless the young people. They've never seen the glory of God. Lord, let some parents radiate with God as they go home. Let homes be different after tonight. Bless this fellowship. We thank you, dear Joyce. Bless her and the others here. Help us to do your will continually, Lord. Make us zealous lovers of God, lovers of the word, lovers of prayer, lovers of the will of God. You give us the Holy Ghost with all the energy to do that, as long as we're obedient. Teach us more and more to be submissive and bring joy to your heart in Jesus' name.